Let's stand and worship together. In 1 Chronicles 16, 8 through 10, it says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him. Tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice." So that's our posture this morning. Let's rejoice in the Lord for what he has done and for who he is. Let's sing together.
Fail me now in the waiting. same God who's never late, is working all things out. You're working all things out. We sing. Well, yes, I will lift you high. Come on. Yes, I. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy.
It's so good to be gathered together, isn't it? And we just want to say happy Palm Sunday. And, you know, here at Harvest, we know that worship is a choice, something that we choose to do. We choose to sing and praise the name of Jesus. And on a day like today, we sing Hosanna, because he's king over all of heaven and all of the earth. Church, everything belongs to him. Jesus is the king that is above every other name. He's above every ruler and every power. We sing Hosanna on Palm Sunday because it's an exclamation of praise. We praise Jesus and we get excited about praising Jesus because he alone has the power to save us from all of our sin and our shame, and he alone has the power to restore us to God, our perfect Father. And I don't know what you brought in with you this morning. Maybe you're here today and you brought in some baggage, some anxiety, some hurt. Maybe you have sin in your life that you haven't dealt with. If that's you, can I just encourage you to worship in faith this morning, knowing that there is a King in heaven powerful enough to carry those things for you? Can I encourage you to worship this morning, knowing that there's a King in heaven that is personable enough to care about you and restore you? And that king is Jesus. And today we get to sing Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest, in response to who he is and what he has done.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the high.
a storm within me, reaching from the inside out. Forever in the making, you're composing even now. I heard it in the heavens, angels circling round and round. No end and no beginning, I lift my voice to join the sound. To join the sound, we sing. Praise God, the name of
you got it.
Conquering king who rode in to Jerusalem on a donkey in all humility. Lord, we thank you for everything that you've done for us, starting at that moment on Palm Sunday when you rode in humility and then conquered death on the cross. And because of that, you are worthy of all of our praise. May it be pleasing to your ears this morning, Lord. We love you and we thank you and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Harvest, go ahead and take a seat. My name is Ramirez Moody. I serve as the Associate Campus Pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus. And man, it's so great to be in God's house, right? Worshiping Him together with His people on His day. And if this is your first time joining us today, I want to extend a very special welcome to you. And just know that you're amongst the welcoming people, and I'm one of them. So I'm going to be in the lobby after service. I love the opportunity to meet you. I'll be next to the welcome sign. I'll stop by. I'd love to see how I could serve you while you're here at Harvest Bible Chapel. Harvest, this is a moment that we can all participate in, and that is through our check-in, through the Harvest Bible Chapel app. So if you have the app on your phone, go ahead and pull your phone out and check in today. We not only want to know that you're here today, but we also like to know how we can be praying for you this week. Also, while you're in there, explore the app a little bit. There's a few cool things in there. And one of those cool things is something that we're really excited about. We're calling it 24 Hours of Prayer. And so we're going to do just that. Starting this Thursday at 6 o'clock, it's going to start off with a worship night at 6 o'clock in the chapel. We're going to gather together, worship the Lord together. And then we're going to go into 24 hours of prayer. And so each person here today can reserve 1 hour of prayer time when you come here to our building and pray with other followers of Christ. And you can choose times from 6 p.m. during the worship set or 2 a.m. A few of us will be here all night long leading that prayer time. So pick a slot. It's so important that we take time out to prepare our hearts for this very important day next week of Easter, all right? Let's not miss anything that God has for us in that. Let's not just make Easter another thing that we check off of our calendar. This is a sacred time that we get to remember what Jesus Christ did for us 2,000 years ago, okay? So take advantage of that through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, all right? Speaking of Easter and Good Friday, we're going to do it like we always do, right? So we will have a Good Friday service on Friday, and you'll have two options there, 5 and 7 o'clock, and then we'll continue with our regular weekend services for Easter next weekend. So for more details, you can go to harvestbible.org, and it's all there for you, and it's also available through the app as well. Harvest, in our continuing effort to pray for like-minded churches, we want to lift up The Orchard and their pastor, Brad Retherell. And in reaching out to The Orchard this week, they just want us to pray that all of the work and efforts that they're putting into their Easter service will yield great fruit in the hearts of those who might not know Jesus. And that's our prayer, too. So we're going to pray for that. But before we do that, I want to share Colossians chapter 3, verse 17 with us, which says this: "And whatever you do in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through Him." As followers of Christ, everything that we do, we want to glorify the Lord in our personal lives, in public and in private, right? But more so with our giving as well. Where our treasure is, there our heart will be also. And so we want to bring glory to the Lord through our giving. And so you have an opportunity to do that through the different options that you see here on the screen. All right? And it's my prayer that the Lord is pleased by our sacrificial giving. So why don't we offer it up to Him in prayer, and let's pray for The Orchard and today's service. Will you join me in that? Lord, we thank You for an opportunity to come together and worship You this morning. And Your word tells us that You are here with us. And so, God, we want to feel Your presence. Will You open up our hearts and our minds to hearing what is will be communicated through Your word this morning. And, God, we lift up The Orchard today, and I just love their hearts of wanting to reach the people in their community. And so, God, will You help them to do that well? Will You open up hearts to the gospel of Jesus Christ in this upcoming week at The Orchard and here at Harvest Bible Chapel? And Lord, we hope that the gifts that we give with a cheerful heart are pleasing to You. Lord, will You use it to take the gospel further than we could have ever imagined? We ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. All right, Harvest, go ahead and grab your Bibles. But before you open them, why don't you greet someone near you, and then we'll get into God's Word.
Harvest, good to see you and good to be in the house of the Lord together. I hope, as you were told, I hope you grabbed a hold of your Bible. Flip over right now to Matthew 13. We're continuing in our series about the parables of the kingdom, and I hope that you've been gleaning a lot from this. I hope that you've been learning a lot. I hope that as you've heard the words of Jesus in these parables that you've been really listening and getting hold of that message that Jesus communicates with us. Not like the husband who would say, you know, my wife says that I have two issues. I don't listen very well, and I can't remember what the other one is. I hope that's not you. I hope you're not like, you know, many parents, many teachers would say to their kids who are there, how many times have I told you this? Be kind. Don't hit your sister. Take your shoes off in the house. Don't eat the crayon. Be nice to one another. How many times have I told you these things? Out of frustration, they would say that. There's a difference between hearing and really listening. There's a difference between hearing the words that are said and actually internalizing those things, actually putting them into action, into practice in our lives. I think I've told you before that I grew up playing hockey, and our coach frequently would scream at us, pass the puck. And we would always, you know, as a bunch of punk kids, we would always be like, I know. And every time he would say the same thing, it's just ringing in my ear. We would say, I know, and he would say, no, you don't know, because if you knew, you'd pass the puck. See, there's a difference between hearing the words, understanding the words that are coming out of someone's mouth, and actually listening, actually putting those things into practice. And so it's my prayer as we look into this passage today in Matthew 13 that we would do that we would have ears to hear. That's the title of our message today. It's something that Jesus repeats several times. Do you have ears to hear the message that Jesus Christ is communicating in his word? I pray that we do, and let's pray right now. Father, we're grateful for the ways that you instruct us. We're grateful for your word, and we are thankful for the words of Jesus that we are looking at today. We would pray that you would open our ears to hear and really listen and really put them into action, all of the things that are communicated to us by our beautiful Lord and Savior, the King who is ushered in his kingdom and we can be a part of now. I would pray that we would understand those things and that we would grow because of what you have done and what you have communicated. Lord, stir our affections to love you in greater ways, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so Matthew 13, we're going to be looking verses 1 through 23. This is the parable of the sower. It's often referred to as the parable of the four soils, but Jesus calls it parable of the sower. So I'm going with that. I hope that's okay with you. The parable of the sower, it is one of the longest that we'll cover in this series that we're going through, parables of the kingdom, and it's probably the most familiar to us, the one that we've heard a lot, and we're understanding at least the where Jesus is beginning from this. But so much about Jesus' message to us is of critical importance. So it's important that we really dig into these four soils and all of the things that Jesus is teaching us so that we wouldn't just hear these words that he says, but that we would really understand them. And we're going to see three things. First, that salvation is hard. And then that salvation is of the Lord. And finally, salvation requires perseverance. First, salvation is hard. Let's start reading in verse 1 of Matthew 13. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea, and great crowds gathered about him so that he got into a boat and sat down. And the whole crowd stood on the beach, and he told them many things in parables, saying, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seeds fell on the rocky ground where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on the good soil and produced grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. So here's Jesus teaching in parables, as we've seen already. And we get a little bit of the context of all of the parables that we're studying here in Matthew 13. You can see him there with crowds around him, people flocking to hear the words of Jesus. I want to hear these stories that he's telling. I want to be around him because we've heard that he's healed people. And so they crowd around him. He's so crowded that they all get on the beach. He gets out on a little boat and goes into the sea there just a little bit. So you can see him sitting on a boat as the whole crowd is all around him on the beach, huddled around trying to listen and hear all of these things. And as he's teaching, we see that he's teaching many things through parables, many of these that we've studied already. He's going to say in the future, but he's talking about a farmer here. And he tells this story. Think about, picture a farmer who's walking through his fields with a bag over his shoulder of good seed. And as he walks through the field, he's taking handfuls of seed and scattering them all across his field. Now, I think a lot about farming, like we see if you hop on I-90 and go west, you see these soybean fields, you see corn fields, and they're nice squares. It's like a grid. You can see exactly where the field is, where the road goes, where the neighbor's field is. It's not like that at all for them. Their fields were all weird, goofy shapes, and there were often paths that went right through the middle of it where people would just cut through people's field to get to town. It wasn't considered rude or inappropriate, but the field was just shaped in weird sizes. It wasn't a nice little grid. And so it's very common for these paths to be there and for these interesting shapes so that as the farmer is walking through sowing seeds, the seed would fall naturally in all sorts of different places as he scattered it. And you can see the path that's here. It would be common for these. And so as it's going, there would be these hard places along the path where the soil was beaten down and the root, seed would not be able to take root. We see the rocky ground. It's not so much ground with a whole bunch of stones in it, but ground with a little bit of soil and the bedrock just underneath. And that's what he says here, is that the seed then takes root, but it doesn't have the depth of its root. And so as it would begin to grow, it would die quickly as the difficult rains would come in, the scorching heat would come in at different times, and the hard wind, it would wither away. And that's what happens there with the rocky ground. It would appear to be fine at the very beginning, but would quickly fade. We see it's among thorns is another place that he sows. And while the seeds would fall there and there would be enough soil for them to grow, they were surrounded by strong plants with thorns that would compete for that same soil space. The two were not able to survive together. And eventually the thorns then would choke out the crop and prevent them from getting any kind of nourishment that they would need in order to grow. And then fourth, finally, we see this good soil that he teaches about. Here alone, this is the seed that produces any kind of harvest, any kind of grain. Each of these that we see, you see 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. Each one of them would be cause for the farmer to rejoice. Each one of them is an excellent crop that would cause them to be happy. But notice that even though there's different amounts, there's different outcome for each of those, the emphasis on the soil is the same. It's all good soil that's producing growth through all of it. You know by now, because this is in our series of parables of the kingdom, and we know ahead of time what Jesus is going to talk about, but this parable is about the kingdom of heaven. That's why Jesus is telling each of these parables. He's telling us that the entrance to this kingdom of heaven is difficult, that salvation is hard. The sower goes out sowing the seed intentionally. He has a plan for there to be grain, for there to be an abundant harvest. That is the goal of all of the sowing, but it's difficult to produce that harvest. Notice that only one of these four soils produces any kind of fruit at all. Only one out of four. And even that, I'm thinking about, and you're thinking about, as you walk through your field that God has placed you in, the places that God has put you as a missionary for him to scatter his seed, to cast his word to people, to bring about the gospel, that workplace that you're in with the people who are there, the school that you go to each day of the week, and you're around those people, your neighborhood, your apartment building, those people in the basketball league that you're in the club that you're a part of. God has put you in that field, and you're the sower. You're the one who's walking through that field, casting seed, praying that people will respond to the good news of Jesus Christ. But salvation is hard. If you've spent any time sowing seed, if you've spent any time telling people in your life about Jesus, you have felt that rejection. You have seen those seeds fall in the places where you would desperately want to see them take root, and yet no fruit comes of that. But here I'm reminded even that so many people don't respond to Jesus Christ, and that is heartbreaking at times. But as we look at this, I don't know about you, but if one out of every four people that I shared the gospel with responded with fruit and with lasting obedience to Jesus Christ, I'd be throwing a party. That'd be amazing. One out of four? That would be great. But we don't even see that harvest. I think there's lots more that we don't see. Jesus isn't talking about the people who don't respond at all, the people who are rejecting, or the people who don't want anything to do with the seed. But what we see here is a clear delineation between the soil that produces a lasting fruit and all of the rest. Because salvation is hard. It's difficult. It is a free offer of the gospel to every person, that each person can turn from their sins and come to Jesus Christ. And God would want that, would desire that, but yet so many turn and reject him. That even though it's a free offer, that even though Jesus stands to each and every person and says, come, follow me, receive eternal life, be a part of the kingdom that I am ushering in right now, so many, most will turn away. And it's heartbreaking for us as we sow that seed and see so many turn from Jesus Christ. It's the message of the gospel that is freely offered to everyone, but most will not receive it. Jesus tells this to his followers in another place, Mark 10:23-27. And Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, so this is right after what we know as the rich young ruler, the person who comes to Jesus and says, what do I got to do to be saved? And he says, why don't you sell all that you have, give all of the money away, leave it all behind, and follow me. That's what Jesus tells to this person. And the man goes away sad because he's unwilling to do that. He's unwilling to turn away from all that he has and say, Jesus, you're worth all of it. I'll follow you. And as he turns away, Jesus looks around and says to his disciples, how difficult, how hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. And the disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus sort of takes it a step further and reminds them, children, how difficult it is to enter the kingdom of God. Salvation is hard. 1 in 4 is all we're seeing here. Most people reject. How difficult it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. And they were exceedingly astonished and said to him, then who can be saved? I've felt like this, where you share the gospel, you sow seed over and over and over, and I'm not seeing any fruit. I'm not seeing anybody come to Jesus Christ. And you stand there and you pray for the people in your life who your heart breaks for, and you say, Lord, who can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, with man it's impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God. That even though salvation is hard, with man it's impossible, but not so with God. For all things are possible with God. Because secondly, salvation is of the Lord. Even though salvation is hard and many, many people will reject, salvation is of the Lord. Let's continue reading in our parable here, Matthew 13. Let's go to verse 10 and following. Then the disciples came and said to him, so we see this a couple of times. We saw it with one of the other parables, where after Jesus tells the parable, the disciples come and they're like, hey, can you explain it to us? Tell us a little bit, what do you mean here? And so the disciples came to him and said, why do you speak to them in parables? And he answered to them, to you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but for them it has not been given. For the one who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled that says, you will indeed hear, but never understand. You won't have ears to hear. And you will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear. And their eyes have closed, lest they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. So Jesus is talking to his followers at this point. I think it's more than just the 12. I think it's the people who've determined that they will follow him. And so you can see them just with Jesus asking these things. Why exactly do you speak in these parables? And Jesus is explaining to them. What's clear from this passage is that there is a crystal clear dividing line between the followers of Jesus and those who don't follow him. Between the soil that does receive him and grow and produce fruit and all the rest. There's a clear dividing line. They have the secrets of the kingdom. If you've come to Jesus Christ, you're part of the in crowd that has the secrets. It's like that group that has the secret jokes, the sort of inside jokes. Have you ever been the person who's on the outside of that? Like, I hate being left out. I hate being the one who everybody else has some text group going and I'm not a part of that. And you sort of sit with these people and they're all telling jokes. Oh, and they're all laughing about it. And you're like, what is going on? I have no idea. Because there's a secret. There's an inside joke that's happening there. And so that's what Jesus is saying here, is that they know the secrets of the kingdom. It is sort of like an inside club. And if you're on the inside, then you can understand the message of Jesus Christ, all of the things that he's teaching. That doesn't exactly sound fair, that there's sort of an inside. I mean, our services, our weekend gatherings, they're open to everybody. Anybody can come. So why here is Jesus saying that there's secrets of the kingdom that is sort of just for the inside people? How do you actually get to be inside? How do I get to join that text group that everybody is a part of? Notice who he's telling this to. He's telling this to his disciples. He's telling this to his followers. He's telling this to the people who he has said to follow me. And as they've stood there with their nets, they have dropped their nets and left everything to follow Jesus Christ. That's how you get inside. All that's required is for you to have knees that you can drop to and say, Jesus, I need you. I'm all yours. And you're inside. You go from an outsider to an insider by that one very act of turning and trusting Jesus Christ. It's not based on what you've done. You don't have to be great at your job even. You don't have to be popular or wealthy. You don't have to have it all together. In fact, it's probably better if you don't have it all together. You don't have to be a part of some exclusive country club. It's not like you have to receive a special secret invitation from someone. All you have to do is repent of your sins and come to Jesus Christ by faith. To say, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I can't do it on my own. I'm a mess without you, Jesus. I need you and only you to forgive me of my sins. And you will see yourself go from an outsider to an insider. Go as somebody who's in the darkness to the light of Jesus Christ. Someone who is dead to someone who has life and abundant life. And here, fruit and a beautiful harvest for the Master. To recognize that you're a sinner. And then you have Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life. You can do all of that. Jesus isn't just speaking in some code that you can't understand. He wants you to turn from your sins and come to Jesus Christ. And you can understand all of the messages that Jesus communicates. It isn't some code that will be hidden to you forever if you're found in Jesus Christ. It's like, have you ever been to the Field Museum? They had this really cool Egypt exhibition there. You walk through and it kind of feels like you're in like a mummy's tomb and all of these kind of things. And they've got like these really cool hieroglyphics like up on the wall. And there's the little bird and the little I and the little R thing and the little, I don't know, you know. And I can walk in and look at all of these hieroglyphics and admire them for the beauty of them. And they look really cool. But I have no idea what that says. I don't get it at all. I can admire it for its beauty, but I don't understand. Years ago, when I was in high school, my family took a trip to a different country, and I remember being in the city there and seeing the graffiti along the city and different overpasses and things like that. And I remember sitting there being like, man, I wish I spoke the language because then I could understand what all of this says. I mean, it's like cool designs and these words, but I have no idea what it says. And then I came back to the city of Chicago and I realized, I speak English. I can't read this either. But you can admire like where those things are. How did that tagger get up there? And oh, look at the colors that she used over there. And look at all of this. You can sort of admire that, but not understand at all what it says or what it means. That's how it is when you're without Jesus Christ. And that's what we would do without Jesus Christ. That's what many did at this time, is Jesus is telling this really nice story about farming. Isn't that great? Oh, we get to hear this really cool story, but to not go beyond that, that Jesus is telling us this because it's about the kingdom. And we need to, and they need to, have ears to hear. Like a child who hears their parents say things over and over, but doesn't hear to obey, the people who are all around Jesus, they don't have ears to hear that. They hear all of the in one ear and out the other, but never really grasping the truth of it. You may have been all around church for years. Maybe you have sat in these rows for weeks and months and maybe years, hearing again and again the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ on the cross for your sin and for mine, that we can be forgiven and cleansed only because of Jesus' sacrifice. And that has gone in one of your ears time and time again, but you don't have ears to hear that. You think about it, that's a really nice story that somebody would do that for somebody else, but you haven't made it your own. You haven't turned from your sins and trusted Jesus Christ by faith. You're the child who the parent continues to tell them to stop hitting their sister, and you just keep on hitting your sister, because you don't have ears to hear. Or maybe it's like the kid who's made up their mind that they hate broccoli. I hate those little trees. They're of Satan. I hate broccoli. No, just try it. It's probably not that bad. You should just try it. And they've made up their mind they're not going to like it. And the second it touches their tongue, I hate broccoli. Because they already decided that they're going to hate it. Maybe you have done that. Maybe you have sat there and been like, that religious stuff is a bunch of garbage. It's only for people who need a crutch and all of those things. That's right. When are you going to figure out that you need the crutch too? Like, maybe you've heard all of those things and you have made up your mind and dug in your heels, I'm fine. Everything, I don't need all of that stuff. And the words just bounce off time and time again. You don't have ears to hear. But Jesus says, turn and I would heal them. Just turn. Like the stubborn man who refuses to go to the doctor, telling everyone, probably even himself most of all, I'm not really that sick. It's fine. It's fine. I'm just rub some dirt in it and I'll be fine. I'll be fine. And his body continues to get worse and worse if he would only accept the fact, I'm really not doing well right now. I'm sick and I need to head to the doctor. And if he would just take that step to get to the doctor, he could get some meds and he would be all better in 3 to 4 days. But as it is, some people are never healed because they just won't go to the doctor and accept the fact that they're sick. How many people just won't accept the fact that I need healing from Jesus Christ? I need to be forgiven of the disease of sin that is all around me. And if you would just have ears to hear the message of Jesus Christ, that you are sick with the disease of sin, and there is only one great physician who has any kind of remedy for that. And it only comes when you will turn and be healed. It only comes when you come to Jesus Christ and say, I am sick and need of healing. Lord, please forgive me of my sin and cleanse me with your righteousness. You would be healed in an instant. And your ears would be open to hear all that Jesus has to say to us. Here he's telling them that you have a blessing because you have this message that so many have wanted to hear and haven't heard all of these truths. Not because the disciples or because we are anything special in and of ourselves, but because God has graciously revealed himself to them and to us. The kingdom is here. That salvation is of the Lord. And if you've come to follow Jesus Christ, it's not because of anything you've done. It's solely because of his grace. And this kingdom that is here for them and here for us, God's people have been waiting and waiting and waiting for it. And it's finally here. Finally, our king rides in to the city on a donkey, not in the way that would be expected, but he rides in. Do you receive him in that way? Because so many people have wanted the privilege that you have right now and haven't had that same blessing. Do you realize that for most of the history of Christianity, Christians did not have a Bible of their own to go read? Like, it wasn't sitting on their shelf for them just to pick up a Bible and turn to it and read it. You had to, like, go to the church and use the Bible that was there. They didn't have it. When I was preparing this message, I'm sitting on my study at home. No joke, from one seat, I counted 27 Bibles in my study. Now, maybe I should give those away or something like that. I don't know. I mean, some of them are like older ones that are kind of falling apart, and I bought a new Bible, and some of them are different translations, and there's all sorts of things like that. But I had 27 Bibles on my shelf. How many do you have on your shelf at home? Like, we have an incredible resource, not to mention the fact that I was sitting in front of a computer with the internet, with a phone in my pocket, with a free Bible app, with the ESV Study Bible, and all of these crazy tools that we have access to. Do you realize how many righteous, God-following people throughout the centuries would have died for what you have and what I have? Are we recognizing that as a blessing? Or do we have ears to hear that? Because the words are all around us if we're listening. It's all there. So are my eyes open? Am I able to hear? Because even today, we're hearing his message. Are our ears open to hear that? Only God can open the ears and the eyes of people to receive Jesus Christ and his kingdom. But today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart, because salvation is of the Lord. And finally, salvation requires perseverance. Let's finish our text, verse 18 of Matthew 13. Here, again, Jesus saying this word. This is just to the disciples, his followers. He's telling all of these things, and he walks through the four soils again. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is what was sown along the path. That's number one. As for what was sown on the rocky ground, number two, this is the one who hears the word, immediately receives it, even with joy, yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while, and when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, and immediately he falls away. As for what was sown on the thorns, this is soil number three, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. As for what was sown on the good soil, number four, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. Jesus is explaining then this parable to his followers. He gives the explanation back to those four soils. These aren't meant, again, to represent everyone ever in the history of the world. They're meant to represent people who are hearing the word of the gospel and how they respond. And he talks about these four types of people. Again, the path, these are the ones who the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the careless hearer. The gospel is shared. They hear it maybe at a church gathering or maybe from a friend, and they think, that's nice. That's good for you. But I mean, I kind of got my own thing, and okay, we'll see. Or maybe it's the person who's around the things of the Lord. They've heard it often. They're the person who's in and out of church week after week. They get the sense, maybe out of duty, maybe out of shame, that I ought to go to church. It's the thing that good people do. And they hear the seed sown time and time again, but they never really understand or grasp its significance. It doesn't take root for them. The seed just sits on the surface, and eventually the enemy takes it away. The rocky ground, then, those who receive it with joy but don't have a root and endure for a while, and then tribulation or persecution arises and they fall away. This is the person who then responds to the gospel even at the beginning. Notice they even respond with joy, but it's short-lived because there's no real depth within them. It's here one day and gone the next. That incredible joy, but then nothing. You go to buy a new car, and you go to the dealership, and you get the color and all of the specifications you want. You get the heated seats. Man, I wish I got heated seats in my car. But either way, you get the one you want, and you sit through hours and hours of that paperwork. Why in the world does it take so long? But you sit through all of that, and then there's so much joy as you sit in your brand new car and you grab the steering wheel and you start the car and you feel the engine rev and you're so excited about it, and they're all waving at you as you drive away and you put it into drive and you pull out just out of the dealership, and bam, somebody hits you and your car is totaled. The joy of a brand new car all just gone in a moment. But notice why it's so short-lived for this person. It's because there's no root, because there's no depth in it, that tribulation comes, that the difficult things of life happen. I didn't know it was going to be like this. I didn't sign up for all of this that's here. You've heard me say before that we bank on a lot of the promises of God that we have in the Word, and I'm so grateful for the many, many promises, the things that you and I can count on. God promised, He's faithful, He's keeping His Word. We should hold fast to those kinds of things, but one of the promises of God that we overlook time and time again is Jesus' promise that you will have trouble. This world is going to be difficult. Your life will be hard. There are trials, there are tribulations, there are things that happen. And it is not different for the believer when the trials actually come. The response might be different because of who you have in your corner. Because Jesus does promise that he has overcome the world, and through him we will overcome the world. There's an incredible promise there. But far too often as Christians, we just think that that's all going to be happy. It's just going to be like those plaques in Hobby Lobby. That's like all of life, that we're just skipping through fields of tulip and life is hard and painful. There's tragedy all around us. You will have suffering. You will have hardship. You will have nights that you are crying yourself to sleep on your pillow. I pray it's not tonight for you, but it's coming. And it doesn't bring me any joy telling you that, but I love you and I want you to endure, because perseverance is what matters in Jesus Christ. Salvation requires perseverance. So don't be surprised, beloved, when the fiery ordeal comes upon you, because it's coming. Difficult days are coming if they aren't here yet. In this life, you will have trouble. And this person, this soil, when those trials come, when the difficulties come, they don't have a root in themselves. They don't have someone that they can bank on and say, Jesus, I don't understand all of this, but you've promised that you will overcome this. So I'm trusting you in the midst of this trial. I'm banking on the roots that I have that are in Jesus Christ. For a plant to remain, its root system needs to be deep enough to handle some of the difficult weather, those difficult days that are coming. Listen, we live in Chicago. Frost is probably going to come in May. It's just the way that it is. It's going to be like 65 degrees in the morning and then like 35 degrees in the afternoon. This is gonna happen. You're gonna walk out the door with sunglasses and then need your parka later in the day. And life is kind of like that for us. I'm walking around, everything seems to be going great. My job's going good, I'm healthy, and my family's great. And then, bam, we pull out of the lot of the dealership and the car feels like it's totaled. So where do you turn in the midst of that? Do you have the roots that are deep enough in Jesus Christ? Because the difficult winds are coming, the scorching heat is right around the corner. And when that difficulty comes for the person who professes faith in Jesus Christ, the person who truly has a root system in him will continue on. It won't be empty words with no root system to back them up. But then he talks about the third soil. This is that among the thorns. This person hears the word. Maybe they don't reject it. We don't see that they receive it with the same type of blind joy. But two things become bigger and more significant for this person. First, the cares of the world. Have you noticed that this world can be a pretty stressful place? Like, not even talking about the trials that are coming, just everyday life. There's the cleaning the house, the caring for the kids, taking them to practice, and the furnace needs work. I still have to do my taxes. That's actually a true statement. I do still need to do my taxes. The garage door is broken. My car needs an oil change again. My boss wants those reports on his desk by Monday. I need to schedule a dentist appointment. It's a lot just to kind of keep track of all of those things. It never stops. And sometimes those cares and the stress and the anxiety that we have, we allow them to crowd out our attention for the Lord and letting his word take deep root in us so that we would have a plentiful harvest. Like a cup that only has so much capacity, and we continue to keep all of that anxiety and all of those cares of this world in the cup so that there's no room for the things of the Lord. I just got too much going on right now. I can't handle it. And then the thorns come and choke out the word. Also, the deceitfulness of riches. We talked about the rich young ruler, but we live in a world that believes that money is the answer to all of our problems. I mean, if you could just win the next Powerball that happens, everything would be great. You would have no problems at all. That's what we believe from time to time. That's why it's deceitful in that. But yet Jesus would say, you cannot serve God and money. You can't allow these things to choke out any sense of faith that's there, because the thorns do choke and that person falls away. And then finally, we have the fourth soil, the good soil, the only one who hears the word, understands it, bears fruit, and yields. They receive it and they remain in it. And that is the mark of the true follower of Jesus Christ. It's not that this person doesn't have trials. It's not that there's no scorching heat for this person. It's that their roots are deep enough in the things of the Lord so as to stand firm in the midst of those trials. It's not that this person doesn't have the temptation of the cares of this world and all the anxiety and stress or the temptation of riches. It's that they didn't allow those things to crowd out their love for their Savior. That the king is worth more than all of it. And so I'm giving it all to him. Their affections weren't placed in those things. They were placed on the only one with the words of eternal life. And the result of all of that is that they bear fruit and yield. Notice there's different yields. There's different amounts of the fruit that are born. But the emphasis in Jesus's parable isn't how much fruit that they're producing. It's are they producing fruit? Because the good soil will produce fruit. What's clear from all three of these is that the fruit that is produced is abundant. Listen, we are, I'll just, to be safer, I am a big dope, but the fruit that's produced in my life, the way that I've been able to love people, that ain't me. The way that you're able to forgive people, that's not you. You're a big dope too. It's okay. We're all messed. That's why we need Jesus Christ. And the things that he's producing in my life and in your life are so much bigger, so much more abundant than anything that is possible on my own. The fruit that's produced for righteousness is abundant. So what would it look like? What would the life cycle look like for the plant that's rooted in soil number 4? Well, we have, you've heard these before, I'm sure. Here at Harvest, we say that an on-mission disciple of Jesus Christ has these 4 marks. First, they're uniquely planted. That you and I have each been planted by the master, by the farmer. You've been put in a specific place. Do you know that God has made you exactly how he wants you for his purposes? That you don't have to look down the row and be like, I wish I was more like her, or I wish I had that thing he does, or I wish I didn't have this going on. God made you exactly the way that he wants you for his purposes. Oh, the scars and the mess and the great things and all of it all together. He's made you the way that he wants you for his purposes. You're his child, and he wants you to be used for him. He's put you in that workplace or at that school or in that cul-de-sac. He's put you there for his purposes. He's uniquely planted you there. So grow there. Don't look around at all the other places. Grow where God has put you. You're uniquely planted. You're also deeply rooted. It's a seed that's sown in good soil, that we're consistently cultivating a deep love for Jesus Christ. And that's one of the ways that we grow to be sure that we will be fruitful later, is we're consistently cultivating a love for Jesus Christ. It's not just on Palm Sunday that we stand and we sing and shout, Hosanna, and we welcome Jesus Christ. We should do that, but each and every day, on the days when there's a great rain coming, watering the crop, we stand and we say, welcome Jesus, take hold of my life and use me for your purposes. And on the days when there's scorching heat and we don't understand a thing that's happening, we say, Jesus, you are welcome to do your work in my life, because I want a deeper love for you in the great rainy seasons and in the scorching heat. And it's in that that we will be deeply rooted, our knowledge of him growing and growing as we love him in greater ways. We're also carefully pruned, uniquely planted, deeply rooted, carefully pruned. This is the one that's not so fun. But God uses the difficulties in our lives to prune us, to shave off areas of our life that aren't in congruence with his word, that aren't honoring to him, that aren't best for our growth and for his glory. And we're trusting the Lord to use those highs and those lows for his purposes, so that I'll bear fruit, so that I'll be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. We're carefully pruned, and then finally, persistently fruitful. That we're producing a profit for the kingdom, that we're reflecting Jesus Christ more and more every day, that we're showing Jesus to the people around us, that I'm taking handfuls of seed and I'm seeking to help plant more seed for the gospel. So as we go through these marks of a disciple, the question is, are you one? Are you the good soil that's producing a good fruit, an abundant fruit for the king? Are you persistently fruitful in all of that? Are you producing fruit for the king? Because who are those who are members of the kingdom of God? This is the parables of the kingdom. So who are those who are a part of the kingdom of God? It's not those who hear the word. It's not those who are genuine in whatever they believe. It's not those who have people around them who follow Jesus Christ. I have a lot of Christian friends. It's those who persevere. It's only those who continue on and produce fruit that are part of the kingdom. A saved person is known by their perseverance. Enduring fruit is what matters in the kingdom. It's what matters in God's field here. Again, this weekend we're celebrating and remembering Palm Sunday, the triumphal entry, where our king rode into the city on a donkey, in humility, not in the ways that were expected that his kingdom would come about, but he was welcomed just the same by shouting, "Hosanna, Lord, come and save us." But there will come a day when that king rides in the way that was expected, when he rides in on a white horse with his robe dipped in blood, and all will declare, "King of kings and Lord of lords." And so the question is, will you receive him? And not just will you receive him, but will you continue in him? Because the one who endures to the end will be saved. To the one who has ears, let them hear. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for this message that you have given us from your word and for this parable that we have of what the kingdom of heaven is like. And Lord, we would pray that you would allow your seed to take root in our heart. God, I would pray for some here hearing that message for the very first time, that they would receive that seed and that you would cause it to grow deep in their hearts, and that we would all produce a bountiful, fruitful harvest for our King of Kings and Lord of Lords, because you're worth it all, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand as we respond?
Yeah.
find the hardest part. We follow Jesus Christ throughout every obstacle, any trouble that may come our way. He's promised to be there with us. Praise the Lord for that. Harvest? Yeah. Praise the Lord for that. Man, great time in God's word today, right? And I can't wait to come back next week. Are you guys ready for next week? Yeah, me too. I'm hyped up. Bring someone with you. But before that, let's get our hearts ready for that, all right? So remember, we have the 24 hours of prayer, and we care for everyone here at our church, like the iPhone users, which you can use the app, but we also care for the Android users. So there's a sign up in the lobby for the Android users. But take full advantage of that. We're going to worship the Lord together at 6 o'clock on Thursday, and then we're going to pray for 24 hours to get our hearts ready. Also, if you attended and registered for the Women's Conference, there's some plants in the lobby. Grab your plant if you have not already done that. Also, this is Disability Awareness Weekend. I don't know if you guys knew that, but we have a ministry here called In His Image. And so when you came in, you saw some of the participants of In His Image Ministry serving at the doors of our church. What a blessing. It's an awesome ministry. It's an outreach ministry that is reaching so many people in our community, and we're just so grateful for that. Also, if you would like prayer for anything, please come up front. Don't leave here without that. And Harvest, as we go out on mission this week, getting our hearts ready for what we have in store next week, remember, you are loved. Have a great week.